Seeking within belief, that is what we're all doing. This is the habit we've had since time immemorial. And the whole trouble is it's just very difficult to break a habit that is we've had for so, so long. That's it. And yet we still have to try to break that habit. And it's frustrating because very few have broken that habit. And when we ask them, how'd you do it? They say, I don't know. You know, just one day I just decided to part ways with that habit. And that was it. I decided I'm not going back to that. And, you know, we will eventually do that. It's like you're hanging out in a place that's not really a good place to hang out in. And one day, you know, somehow you just decide, you know what, this isn't good for me. I'm not going back there. And then you never return. You just don't return. The place is still there. You can go back if you want to. But you just say, no, I'm not going back there. I'm not going back to this place. You know, it could be like a bar. Like you hang out in a bar for, you know, 20 years. Every night you go to this bar for 20 years. And then one day you just realize, you know what, I'm getting older. Starting to feel my aging. I'm starting, you know, to realize, wow, my mortality is creeping up on me. And you know what? That bar is just not really serving me very well anymore. And then you decide, you know, hey, why not make a clean break with it and just say that's it. And then you just say, don't go back to it ever again. You're finished with it. It really has to be something like that, because we can clarify to the nth degree. We can be in a bar and we can see everything. I don't like this, I don't like this, I don't like this, I don't like any of this stuff. And yet the next day, you know, you go back to the bar again. It's familiar habit, routine. Sit on a bar stool, order a drink, sit there and spend some time and say, I don't like the place, I don't like anything about it. And yet I'm just, you know, just feel almost like powerless to not go. And then one day you decide, I'm through with it. That's it. How does that happen? How do you get to the point where you just decide you're through with it? And it's that simple. We're all looking for some kind of aha breakthrough type of thing. I don't believe it. I'm not seeing it like that. I used to see it that way, and it's never happened. So now I'm seeing it very differently. That it is not a spectacular breakthrough or anything like that. It is simply, you just decide, you know, you're finished with belief. You're not going to seek within belief anymore for what you really want. So that's a habit that's time to part ways with that habit. And you just part ways with it. And then you're simply abiding in your true identity. I see it. I can't use the word belief. That's a bad habit, right? I see it as like that. That is simply somehow one day you just say that, okay, enough's enough. Enough's enough. That's it. Not going back there. And it's finished just like that. No trumpets, you know. It's not like doing some yogic exercise and you know, you're doing all this stuff and you know, I don't know. Whatever type of yogic stuff you're doing, and then suddenly you go, ah, I got it, you know. It's not like that. It's not like that. It's just like you realize that belief is a horrible habit. It is just this terrible, terrible habit that we have had for so long. And we see it as a habit now. We recognize it is nothing but drinking the wine of folly. And there is no identity within belief. Belief keeps saying there's some identity there. We're supposed to find it. We're searching. Where's this identity? You know, belief keeps saying, who am I? Who am I? Who am I? Who am I? And we say, well, I can answer that, you know. Our identity, we know we have our identity. And yet we can't answer it because there is no identity within belief. Belief is the denial of identity. So we keep searching for, you know, who am I? And thinking we need to answer, who am I? Who am I? Who am I? We don't need to answer that. Because belief is the denial of identity. It cannot know what identity is. So we have this terrible habit of just going on these wild goose chases within belief. It's just wild goose chases. It's all it is. And you can see it, and you can see it, and you can see it, and you can see it. And you get up the next day and you go on another wild goose chase. Just because it's what is done. It's what is done here, you know. You get up and there's 7 billion people going on a wild goose chase, and you say, well, you know, I guess I need to go on a wild goose chase, even though your heart's not in it, you don't really want to. It's like going to that bar. You say, I don't want to go to that bar. I hate going to that bar. I hate going there. Don't want to go there anymore. And yet, you suddenly realize, there you are. You know, whoa, I went there again. What's going on? It's like that. That's why people go to all these retreats. They go to all these satsangs. They go to the teachers, and you know, they're 50, 60 years old now, and they've spent a lifetime, and still they're just like ending up in the bar of belief. And they wonder, what am I doing here in this bar? I know it's I can't find anything I want here, and yet here I am, just still hanging out here. You know, what's the secret? There is no secret. What's the answer? You know, the answer is, there's some answer as to how is it that anyone finally decides to say, hey, you know what? I'm not going back to that bar ever again. I'm finished with it. Because we only through that can we know our identity, which is constancy. It's not partial. We don't have a sometimes identity. It's not here today and gone tomorrow. It's constant. We go into the bar of belief, it's a denial of constancy. It's a denial of the constant. It's a denial of our identity. So if we go into the bar of belief, we're going to say, whoa, my identity isn't constant because I can't find it here. Where is it? It's gone. So if we go back into the bar of belief, you know, we're going to just feel like, whoa, reality, you know, is not permanent. And if it's not permanent, you know, is there really anything to go back to? It feels more rational to try and develop something permanent, right? Because we know what we really want is, we want permanency, certainty, immutability. And if we believe that reality is changeable, we won't really want it. We'll try to go with belief and try to build something that is permanent. You know, pour it in concrete. So that just, you know, feeds back into the bar of belief hanging out there even more. So we cannot oscillate between the two. That just actually strengthens belief. Because that oscillation, we will take it, we will believe that it means that reality is not permanent, even though that's not true. It's that belief is a denial of reality and cannot see it, cannot accept it, and doesn't know it at all. Belief is the opposite of knowing. It's a not knowing. So it's more accurate to say, We knew reality, and now we're choosing to not know it, to believe it's possible to not know it, believe it's possible to change it. And yet, within belief, we don't see it that way. So the oscillation thing is not a smart plan at all. What we need to do is to walk out of that bar of belief and say, you know, that's it. I'm not going back there. You know? So that is the trouble. That is why if you look at the world and you try to look for those who have done this, you know, it's hard to find. It's hard to find. It's not common. Because where are those who walked out of the bar of belief and never gone back? Never returned? So that's it. They decide they're not going back. And that's what's needed. That is the decision. And so you can see that maybe that's not so easy for us. Because we think there's some stuff in the bar we're used to or familiar with. We feel like we need to hang out there in the bar of belief. Maybe to get us develop a sense of identity or try and develop something permanent. Because we're not certain that reality is permanent, you know. That's belief insists. It believes that reality is not permanent. And everything within belief is impermanent. So we have all this false evidence, believing that this is probably true of reality as well, that reality is impermanent, even though it's not. And so we believe, like, hey, why don't we at least keep working on trying to build something through process, build something permanent. So if reality turns out to not be permanent, we'll have something permanent. And that keeps us engaged with belief, keeps us, you know, engaged in wanting belief to succeed at what it's trying to do. Of course, what we don't tell ourselves is that what belief is trying to do is develop a permanent threat to reality, a permanent way to destroy reality. We don't tell ourselves that. That rarely comes up in any satsang, in any discussion whatsoever. But it's very important, because this will lessen your time in the bar of belief. If you recognize this, you say, wait, whoa, you know, we're just being played for fools. Belief is playing us for fools. It really is. Belief doesn't care about us at all. It wants to destroy us. It wants to destroy reality. And yet this is its mystery. You know, belief always talks about a mystery. That at the core of belief, belief insists there's a mystery. at the heart of it, there's a great mystery. It is simply the unspoken fact that belief is trying to develop a permanent threat, a way to permanently threaten it and destroy reality. And it's using us as experimental. It's using these body minds as experimental guinea pigs in this plan of how to develop this permanent threat. And again, belief doesn't believe that there is any true identity at all. There is no reality, there is no spirit, there is no prime creator. None of that. Belief believes that's just a fairy tale mythology of insanity as it continues to pursue the process of manufacturing something permanent threat to reality. So there's no mystery to what's going on at all. Zero mystery. Everything is very, very clearly obvious. There's no mystery at the heart of belief, of existence. None whatsoever. And yet, we protect this mystery by ignorance. We refuse to look there. And we try to infer what is there instead of simply looking there. You can just look at existence, and you know, it's the most obvious thing imaginable. Existence is completely obvious. And yet we're not willing to look at it, because we want, if we did, we'd say, whoa, you know, I don't think I want to hang out here in belief anymore. And then we're kind of afraid, like, well, maybe I'll miss out on permanency, on certitude, on stability, on truth. I'll miss out on it because somehow belief is going to be able to manufacture this somehow. And of course, we're all busy, you know, the world's busy manufacturing, turning out stuff, working, researching, always trying to, you know, advance, quote-unquote, knowledge, advance knowledge. Knowledge of what? Knowledge of what is the question. Knowledge of what? Sure, there's all sorts of healing and ways of defending against destructivity. And again, that's exactly the plan, is to try to ferret out reality's defenses by continually bringing something of supposed value to the front, and then finding ways to defend it from destruction, and then kind of thinking like there's some way of reverse engineering, figuring out, you know, what the defenses of reality are, so we can develop a permanent threat to those defenses. And again, as I've said many times, reality doesn't have any defenses. So belief is just making all this stuff up. Tilt at windmills. And it's just a bad habit we have. And it's how do we get to that point? Well, satsang is the way. Inquiry is the way. Contemplation is the way. Consideration, pondering, meditating, using whatever expedient we can find to draw our attention back to the central root of the situation. The only way we're really going to finally be done with the bar of belief, with attending the bar of belief, is to look at the totality of belief without hiding anything and seeing it as it is. And we see, the more we see it as it is, the closer we get to saying, ah, okay, I'm not, this is nothing here. I'm not coming back to belief. That's it. Never again. No more. No mas. What belief does is it tries to stall, delay this eventual decision to break this habit and not come back to the bar of belief by getting us to focus on all sorts of details, little details, you know. It's like we want a haircut. We go into the barber or salon. We say, we want a haircut. We want to take all the hair off. And the hair cutter says, well, okay, how many hairs do you want cut? And how long do you want each hair cut? And do you want, you know, this one cut how much? And this one cut how much? And, you know, spending, you know, 15 minutes on every single hair on your head, asking you, you know, exactly how you want that particular haircut. And then when you go through every hair on your head, the barber will say, no, wait a minute, I forgot exactly, you know, exactly how you want it, so let's go over it again. And you say, you should just say, no, just, you know, take it all off. So belief, it tries to delay us from the inevitable, and delay, constantly getting our attention, trying to answer questions, constantly saying, what are, you know, answer this question. Now, you know, how much of this hair do you want to cut? And the truth is, you want it all hairs cut, because it's taken off. It's not a question of how much do you want them cut. If you're taking all the hairs off, the question of how much do you want this haircut is ridiculous. You want it cut at the root. All hairs cut at the root. One answer for all hairs. That is what Satsang Inquiry does, is keep directing you to that one, you know, one answer for everything. Just, you know, drop belief. Go beyond belief. There's no way to accomplish the impossible. To generalize perfectly and say, cut all hairs right at the root of the scalp, you know, right at the root. Boom, one answer, done, like that, done in, you know, five minutes or less. Instead of an eternity of wrangling over each hair separately. And so Satsang is very helpful. The clarification is very helpful because it keeps pointing to the root of the situation. To the very root of the situation, keeps exposing, you know, the root of it, saying, here's what you, where you have to do the cutting, here's where you have to do the leaving, leave it at the root, here's where you part ways with belief, you part ways with all of belief, not with belief in this or belief in that or belief in that, you part ways with belief in the abstract, just belief. It doesn't matter what it, belief in what doesn't matter. Because a belief is a denial of what is. So why does it matter what belief we part ways with? Belief can never rest upon truth. It's always a failure to see what is. It's just parting way with failure. That's all. Nothing but failure. Belief is never give us what we really want. Total failure. And at some point we will decide that we're just not going to engage with failure anymore. Not interested in it, no matter how grandiose the plans of belief are, it's inherently rooted in failure. We can never succeed at giving us resting upon truth, reality, certainty, immutability. So the helpfulness of clarification, of inquiry, of satsang, contemplation, is continually going back to that root and exercising that capability to look at it in the totality of it. That you don't want any of belief. You don't want any belief at all. You don't want belief itself. You don't want to, because it's hopeless, it's futile, it's impossible. You don't want that. It'll never give you what you want. Instead of trying to engage in all these, you know, how much of this hair do we want cut? Questions, trying to answer. That just wastes our life. And before you know it, we're sick and we're dying and we're dead and we're in the afterlife. And we're getting moved through the afterlife to another birth. Before we know it, it's just like that. It's just a cumulative thing of getting fed up with the folly of belief. And recognizing, even when we recognize there's nothing there, it's still just a habit. We just say, well, you know, I just might as well show up again. Sometimes, you know, there are those stories of those who come across realized beings, those who have chosen a different causal agent other than the desire to be prime creator, and so they're not drawn to engage with belief at all. It's effortlessly that they're not engaging with belief. They're engaged with unconditional love effortlessly. Some come across those beings that are here, those ambassadors of certitude, and they suddenly decide that they're finished with belief. They just decide, you know, hey, that's it. I'm finished with it. And then, boom, you know, they are abiding in what is, the awareness of what is, awareness of truth. And there you go. You say, wow, you know, that teacher has some kind of amazing powers. But it's just something that, like, it's the straw that, you know, breaks the camel's back. It's kind of that tipping point where someone is already very fed up with this habit of belief and realizes there's nothing there in it, but it's simply, you know, running on fumes. It just seems like there's this familiarity of habit, and that's all that's going on. There's no conviction in belief. There's no, you know, real desire for belief to be true or to engage with belief or any of that. It's just not there. It's simply habit is there. And in those cases, coming across a great ambassador of certitude and certainty can be that little boost, the big boost, that the habit is broken. And one says, okay, I'm not going back to belief anymore. That I'm finished with it. That can happen. That has happened. Now, karma is all belief, 100% belief. How could reality, sin, do something wrong? To do something wrong, something has to be threatened, right? Something has to be harmed. You cannot harm reality. You cannot threaten reality. So how can reality generate any karma, good or bad? It's ridiculous. Totally ridiculous. So deciding that you're not going back to belief is not a product of karma or anything like that. You're fed up with karma, fed up with the whole concept of karma, fed up with reincarnation, fed up with karma, fed up with yogic powers and psychic powers and meditation, and you're fed up with, you know, spirituality and fed up with teachers and everything that arises, you know, in belief that, you know, that belief is showing us, perception itself. We're fed up with perception. At that point, we just say, hey, you know, that's enough's enough. I'm fed up with this. Not going back to it. Just kind of, you know, it's worn out its welcome. It's worn out its welcome entirely. And then you welcome back home. Welcome back to sanity. Welcome back to sanity. Insanity, you know, you just finally say, I'm done with insanity. No more. No mas. That's it. And then others will go to the same teacher and they won't get it. Why? Because they still want belief to be true. And they're just trying to, they believe the teacher has some magical power to give them what they really want, that there's some way for belief to manufacture permanency, certitude, immutability. And they believe the teacher has some miraculous power to accomplish that. Teachers don't have any miraculous powers. Where is the miracle? Reality is already real. It doesn't need to be made real. Belief will never be real. So where's the miracle? There's no miracle. The only miracle is saving time to recognize and to drop, you know, belief. That's the only miracle there is saving time to, so we get drop belief, you know, sooner rather than later. It's not an altering of what is. And again, we can get tired of seeking for miracles, you know, also fed up with that. Because as long as we put miracles in the context of belief, we're believing that there's some way for belief to construct the permanent. And we're just waiting for the miracles for that to happen. And it will never happen within belief. The permanent already is from the very beginning. Reality began as permanency. There was no point when it was impermanent. None whatsoever. So, it's not a waste of time to consider these things, because it's gradually, you know, the horizon, the total picture is gradually coming into focus. You're sort of trying to focus it in, trying to see what's going on in existence. And even though there's a ton of out-of-focusness in this world, in fact, this world is so out of focus, it's unbelievable. And so if you want to get belief in focus, the whole situation in focus, so you can see what you really want and recognize there's something you need to drop, some habit you need to drop. We just have this one bad habit, but it's a really bad one. The good news is we have only one bad habit. And the bad news is it's a really bad habit. It's a very strong habit. That's the trouble. So we don't need to go chasing after a bunch of other habits. That's a waste of time. I'm telling you for sure that belief will waste your time, unbelievably waste your time, waste your time, waste your time, by chasing after all sorts of corrective measures, trying to, you know, get rid of this and this habit and that habit and that and that, and trying to make yourself a better person. And all of that is pretty much just a waste of time. Belief will tell you, oh, you got to do this first. No, just try to put your attention on the root of the situation through listening to someone who is able to do that for you, help you do that. Spend your time that way. And you, one day you'll realize you bypassed all that other stuff and you look back at the world and everybody's still completely engaged in it. You say, oh my gosh, that is shocking, frightening, that to see just how enmeshed the world is in delay. Is it? The world is enmeshed in delay, and it is the future is simply traumatic. That's it. It's very easy to know. What is the future? It's traumatic. And what are people engaged in? Delay. That's it. Nothing else. So it's not impossible to help others. You simply have to keep on emphasizing, look at the root of the situation. What is arising? What is it that all this arising? Where did it come from? What's the purpose? What's the agenda? And keep telling, you know, the agenda. It's to develop a permanent threat to reality, to force the prime creator to change reality so that spirit can be prime creator. That's why you have all this trauma. You have suffering. You have dying. You have impermanency. All that stuff didn't come from reality. None of that in reality whatsoever. The only way it can arise, the only way any of this could arise, is if the spirit had the desire, the idea of wanting to change reality. And how could that idea possibly arise unless spirit wanted to be prime creator? That's the only reason spirit would want to change reality at all. It's the only thing that's possible. So that's why you can infer that this spirit definitely chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator, greater than God, change reality. And all of this is an attempt to figure out a way to change reality. It's very, very obvious if you look directly at it. But this direct looking is not so easy, because belief keeps telling us to not look, to go chasing after, you know, rainbows, to be counting grains of sand on a beach. You know, you can, a sane person would go to a beach and say, oh, there's a beach, there's the ocean, there's the beach. And belief will say, how do you know there's a beach there? You know, how many have you counted the grains of sand? Do you really know for sure that there is a beach? Maybe you should start counting the grains of sand. It'll have you counting the grains of sand, you know, as long as possible. You know, total waste of time. Total waste of time. If you want to get out of the forest, don't spend your time counting the trees. Just recognize you're in a forest. There's lots of trees. So, you know, elevate above the forest. Don't spend your time counting trees. So, existence is just delay. If you know the truth about existence, it is merely delay. That's all that it is. Nothing else. Because if we don't delay, we'll drop it. And then there's no there. There's nothing to it anymore. You'll recognize it was always zero. And you'll abide in what is. So it's, existence is nothing but delay. And the future is nothing but trauma. Because trauma is how the process whereby belief is trying to develop some permanent threat to reality. It has to keep raising us up to strike us down, to see how we defend our little vulnerability, our little castle. You know, the body mind is like a little castle. And how do we, you know, fight off this and that, this bug, this virus, this disaster, this illness, this depression, this misery, this attack, all these things. How do we, you know, defend our little castle? And then belief is examining all these defenses, and it's fun. Then it studies them, finds ways to get past these defenses, raises up more little castles, you know, bigger castles maybe. And again, it just keeps on doing this over and over and over and over. We're just being used. Body mind is just being used. It's just a pawn in this. That's nothing more than pawns, guinea pigs, laboratory rats. That's all that's going on here. And the future is simply more of the same trauma in all its many guises. All its many guises. You know, I've lived a life of just observing. I could see so much trauma that people tend to just, you know, they ignore it. They kind of just say, oh, that's just, you know, just life. That's life. That's life. No, it's not. It's trauma. It's delay. And in that delay, it's trauma. People are being traumatized constantly. The whole planet's being traumatized. Everything on the planet's being traumatized. You think animals like being, you know, hunted down, or that, you know, the predatory nature of existence. You think, you know, oh, that's just the way it is. That's nature. No, they don't like it. It's trauma. Being traumatized. Everything is under threat. Everything in existence is under threat. Everything in belief is under constant threat. And, you know, it's traumatic. You might say, well, who's being traumatized? Well, belief is traumatizing itself. And to the extent that we want belief to be true, we desire belief to be true, we will experience fear. So that this trauma really engenders fear within belief also. And so, you know, we just, spirit is somehow doesn't feel right about itself at all. Doesn't feel right about itself. And we're not talking about just, you know, humans. We're talking about the totality of belief. all the planets, everything that's ever arisen anywhere within belief is constantly being traumatized, under threat, nonstop. And recognition of this is being held back simply by delay. Existence is delay. Future is trauma. Trauma, delay. Delay, trauma. As we delay, trauma is taking place. What is happening in existence? Trauma is happening. And delay is happening. It's not a real happening, but delay is each moment. It's just delay. We're just delaying breaking this habit of belief. It's inevitable. We will drop it at some point. It's just we're delaying it. Belief keeps churning out questions for us, keeps churning out paths for us. Infinite number of paths, infinite amount of spirituality, spiritual techniques, spiritual practices, investigations, quantifications. What can we do about this social problem? What can we do about that? You know, how can we wipe out hunger, wipe out poverty, wipe out this, wipe out that, get rid of this? How do we do? You know, the question is when are we going to drop belief, which is the root of all trauma? Without belief, there's no trauma. Drop belief, there is no more trauma at all. There's no more sickness, there's no more dying, there's no more trauma of any type. So we have all this world full of people researching how to get rid of this or that, and very, very few who are looking to simply drop belief, go beyond belief, which means going beyond trauma altogether. No more trauma at all, in any way, any guise whatsoever. None, zero. So why are we trying to get rid of a particular trauma when we can very much get rid of all trauma? When it is not so difficult, it's a matter of lessening delay to the point where we drop belief, we get rid of all trauma. It's not, and we won't get there by focusing on individual traumas like cancer and this and this and that, you know, all these traumas. That's not the path. Because belief will always, we get addicted to specific, going after specific traumas, which is exactly what belief wants us to do. Because it's then saying, aha, you know, how are we defending against this trauma? Which then it studies that defense, and then it builds up an attack that can, you know, attack this defense. The one thing that belief cannot handle is if we look at getting rid of all belief altogether. Drop all trauma. Drop the root of trauma altogether. There's nothing there to study, because then there's no more belief to study it. Reality doesn't need to study how to attack itself. It's only belief, and if there's no more belief, there's no more call to study defensiveness. So it's interesting, because the world is engaged in trying to target certain traumas, right? Well, we admit, hey, there are some traumas. Let's get rid of some of these traumas. And yet, right in front of our faces, always, we have the capability right now to drop belief, choose a new idea, choose the idea of not desiring to be prime creator, not desiring to choose to change reality, not wanting to change reality. Acceptance, choose the idea of accepting reality as it is. And what arises out of that is a completely non-traumatic effect. We call it unconditional love, if you like. Totally non-traumatic. No possibility of that effect being traumatized. None. And that's what we would have. We'd be experiencing that instead of experiencing this trauma and trying to attack, you know, some trauma. Like, let's wipe this out. You know, let's wipe out this type of trauma. It goes on and on. Drama goes on and on and on. It gets worse, and it gets more supposedly more subtle, more insidious. Eventually, you end up with ennui, just severe boredom. This terrible ennui, which is really the worst trauma. there is this type of feeling of hopelessness. It's just like, hey, you know, nothing works. It just goes on forever. This is going on forever. That terribly traumatic feeling, which is the worst trauma. And the way to get rid of that is you have to drop all trauma. Because you're feeling the futility, and that you're so weary of this futility. You get weary of the futility, and you just say, I'm tired of this, engaging with this guinea pig thing of constant trauma for so long, and just tired of it. You feel tired of it. And that's really, you know, that's really the worst. And then you say, wait a minute, you know, how do I get rid of this feeling of this is all just futile? I'm just going around in circles, and I'll go around for circles forever. I'll be going around in circles forever. Imagine how you feel when you have this feeling like you're locked into futility and nonstop trauma forever. Forever. With no possibility of getting free of it forever. And how does that feel? You know, that is one terrible feeling. And I've been through that, so I know it's the worst. It's the worst. And then from there, you say, whoa, I've got to find a way to get disengaged from this feeling, because I can't stand it. I cannot stand it. You know, sicknesses come and go all the time. People die all the time. But to have this feeling of like a living futility, an eternal futility, which eventually does come in belief, you no longer believe in belief, but you're not aware of how to get disengaged from belief, that's a shocker. When you no longer believe in belief, but don't know about disengaging from it. So that is when you start on the real spiritual path, and you come across those who point out to you, yeah, there is an option, and it's okay to disengage from belief. And then you start to feel some kind of hope that you can really get free of trauma altogether. No more sickness, no more dying, none of that. Whatever happens to the body has absolutely no relevancy to what you're experiencing at all. Trauma has no relevancy, because what you're experiencing cannot be traumatized, cannot be changed, because it's the idea of not trying to change anything. That so that effect has no dynamic of trying to change what it is, trying to threaten itself. No dynamic of trying to threaten itself whatsoever. No dynamic of trying to traumatize itself, to figure out a way to threaten reality. None of that. And the question always is, well, what is it that's holding us back? That is inquiry, you know? How come we still don't, you know, drop belief? And that is what inquiry is, to look very carefully at this and recognize there's all sorts of, like, kind of delaying tactics that we've been using to scare ourselves. Why? Because we wanted it to be true. We desire to be prime creator. We wanted there to be a way. And so in our very intense will that there be a way, we ignored the fact that we were just deceiving ourselves and just scaring ourselves and traumatized, trying to make believe that we can traumatize what we are. We just, sort of in a mad rush, you know, we just ignored all this. And now we're looking at it and say, oh gosh, that's terrible. Look at all these tricks I've been using on myself for all this time, wasting time, delaying, deceiving, self-deception of every type. How come I didn't catch it before? Well, that's crazy. Why? Because we had this adventurousness and this will to do it. We want belief to be true. We wanted it to succeed. And so we overlooked any and all indications that it could not succeed. We simply had the will of like of obliviousness to it. We ignored it. We insisted on ignorance. And when we look at the world now, when I look at it, what do I see? I see ignorance. Willful ignorance is what I see. Let's be honest here. Directly to the point. And I'm telling you for sure, when I look at the world, I see willful ignorance. All ignorance is willful. All of it. It just doesn't arise out of nowhere. It is willful. Because we want to succeed. We want belief to succeed. We have the will that it succeed. And so that willfulness pushes us into unbelievable programming and delusion and repetitive habituation to try and ignore the futility of it and to ignore the willful ignorance. So you might say existence, willful ignorance, delay, trauma. Trauma, willful ignorance equals delay. Okay, it's all traumatic. Existence is nothing but trauma. Because we want it to be true, we're delaying, we're using all these delay tactics, and because we have the will that it be true, that it should work, we ignore all evidence to the contrary. We ignore all these delaying tactics, and we see it as if it's some kind of process that's succeeding, and we just ignore any evidence to the contrary. Ignore it. Willful ignorance. So really, you know, as far as trying to help others, there is this willful ignorance in the world. And what can you do? What can you do? Because they willfully ignore any evidence to the, you know, at all. Nothing you can bring up, well, they simply willfully ignore it. It's like a political candidate who is completely flawed, and people just willfully ignore, you know, all the flaws. They don't see it at all. No, there are no flaws. No flaws there. Yeah. That's the world. The world willfully ignores, you know, incredible flaws. If they want something to be true, if they really believe, no, this is the means to get what I want, they will ignore it. Willfully ignore it. All ignorance is willful. And there's a massive amount of willful ignorance in the world. So, you know, asking for proof. Proof to who? How can you prove something to willful ignorance? In other words, willfully ignoring evidence to the contrary. Evidence that shows that they're engaged in futility. Willful ignorance of that. Saying, no, that's not so. This will succeed because we got this. We got a trick that's going to make us succeed. No. The trick is to delude oneself into believing it will succeed when it's obvious it cannot. You cannot have that which is immutable also be mutable or changeable. You cannot have that which is unchangeable also be changeable. That's insanity. Insanity is not sanity. See, obviously, there's a difference, right, between that which says the unchangeable cannot be changed, with that sanity, and then one saying that the unchangeable can also be changeable, that insanity. There's a complete black and, you know, night and day difference between the two, obviously. And yet, the world is full of willful ignorance of that, just willfully ignoring it, as if it had nothing, no bearing on anything at all. And so they continue to, you know, flounder about in this ocean of self-delusion, ocean of trauma, ocean of delay. And really, this willful ignorance is worked at, is cultivated. Like a religion. It's the religion of existence. Constantly cultivating this willful ignorance of what existence really is all about. And what that willful ignorance does, it gives a feeling that success is possible. That spirit can become prime creator. That there's a feeling that somehow we're going to succeed. It's that feeling, like one way or another, somehow we're going to succeed. By just ignoring all evidence to the contrary, it gives this sort of false hope. But to those who are fed up, you know, we can look at this and say, yeah, that's what I used to do. Yeah, that's the bar stool I used to sit on. That's the drink I used to drink. And that's the music in the jukebox I used to listen to. That's the dance I used to dance. All of that stuff, you know, we say, that's what I used to do. Okay, I used to do that, and I don't want to do that anymore. I used to do that. We've all done it, so it's just a matter of being honest and say, yeah, that's what I used to do. That's what I used to be habituated to. And that's what I'm getting close to dropping. Dropping the whole scene. See the whole scene, so you can drop the whole scene. The whole scene of existence. See the whole scene. It's trauma, delay, and willful ignorance. That's what it is. And it stems from spirit wanting to be prime creator, choosing the idea, wanting to experience. Well, wanting to experience and choosing an idea are synonymous. When spirit chooses an idea, it's obvious it wants to experience that idea. And this idea cannot be experienced, so there's a desire arises. In other words, desire means not yet experiencing it. Whereas in reality, all their ideas are experienced immediately, instantly, no gap. But the idea of being prime creator cannot be experienced, so it desire to experience it arises, which gives rise to time and belief, and willful ignorance, trauma, delay. We can see the whole scene like that. See the whole scene. And that's all that needs to be seen. See the scene. And that's all that needs to be seen. The scene needs to be seen, and once seen, doesn't need to be seen anymore. You don't need to make the scene anymore. What we try to do is while we're being traumatized, we try to have fun. I remember some public figure, you know, really went through so much trauma that he said, you know, we were just trying to have fun. But it really wasn't fun. It was trauma. We're all trying to have fun. Somehow have some kind of fun, but, you know, it's very superficial. All the while, trauma is sneaking up on us constantly. Our vulnerability is constantly with us. It's like a shadow. Except it's a shadow that is going to pull us down into shadowness, you know. Like it's going to turn us into a shadow, as it were. There's always this feeling of vulnerability, vulnerability, vulnerability. Trauma, 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 trauma. How can we, you know, have fun? You know, try to... It's kind of like, you know, we feel like life is so difficult to bear, but we just got to find a way to somehow bear with it. Be artful in our lives, artful in living, you know, and put the right seasoning on the rice. That's just all, you know, folly, ridiculous. We have to drop trauma. If we don't drop it, it's going to be there. If we don't disengage with belief, we will be engaged with belief. We're engaging with belief, we're engaging with trauma. With the notion of vulnerability, notion of impermanence. We're engaging with that. And we're feeling as if we were, our identity, our truth is threatened. We fear that it's being threatened. It's not being threatened. But our experience is one of fear. When we choose the idea of wanting to be prime creator, our experience is one of fear. We simply experience fear. And all of this stuff, you know, belief is basically a way to try to dissipate this fear. Distract from this fear, we just feel fear. The fear gets, you know, projected into all this, you know, life forms and all this trauma and death, and as a means to try and develop a way to, you know, permanently threaten reality, force the prime creator to change reality, and then we'll be prime creator, and that's when we believe the fear will leave us, when we succeed at this long, long path we've been on of trying to get rid of fear. The way to get rid of fear is to choose a new idea. choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator, no more fear. It's gone. Don't have to threaten reality. It's automatic. So we're trying to get rid of fear in the wrong way by trying to succeed at developing a permanent threat to reality and forcing the prime creator to change reality and make us prime creator. We're trying to get rid of fear in that way, which involves this long, lonesome valley, a trail of tears, a trail of trauma, the trauma trail. We've been on this trauma trail so long because we have bought into this belief that this is, you know, this is how we figure out how reality defends itself and how to destroy those defenses. And we're just bit by bit by bit, we're piecing it together, life after life after life, death after death after death. We're piecing together the mystery, the puzzle of how reality manages to remain invulnerable. That's the path, you know, that trail of tears, the trail of trauma, the trauma trail. We've been on it for so long, and it's futile. We don't get rid of fear that way. We get rid of fear by choosing a new idea, by spirit saying, you know what? All that this idea of wanting to be prime creator gives me is fear. That's all it will ever give me. So I want to choose a new idea, choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator. Unconditional love, acceptance of what is arises, the feeling of accepting what is arises, and there's no trauma there, and there's no fear there, because it's not. There's not a belief, a desire to threaten what we are, because we are reality. Reality is one. It's all inclusive. So every aspect of reality is totally inclusive, included in reality. It is reality. So when we're trying to change, you know, threaten reality, we're trying to threaten ourselves as well, and that's fearful, you know. And so keep looking at the root of it. Keep looking at the root of it. Don't, you know, belief will keep tricking you over and over and over to, you know, go research this, study this, figure out, you know, how many angels can dance on the head of a pin, that kind of stuff. Waste of time. And the more you get familiar with looking at the root of it, you one day you'll look back and you say, oh my gosh, I left all that other stuff behind. It doesn't really tempt me anymore. Just, you know, a little bit here and there, but I'm not stuck in it anymore. I'm not stuck. There's no real desire to engage in that delay anymore. And you realize that you look back and you see everyone else is still engaged with all this delay, and you're not anymore. That's when you start, aha, you know, time wisely spent, moving towards choosing a new idea, experiencing the overlay, that which, the effect which is not trying to change what it is. All the effect that is not trying to change what it is, and not trying to change the one that chose this, the cause, not trying to change the cause, not trying to change what it is, and try to be the effect that's the cause of the cause, not an effect trying to become a cause, not just accepting at the effect, accepting what it is. Bliss, nirvana. Right there, then and there. And we need to get after that, because get after this focusing on the root, so we have this habit, so we can keep doing it when times get very full of turmoil, super traumatic, super delay oriented, very fragmented, all this stuff, search here, search, everybody's searching, everybody's, you know, counting votes, okay, this is a super delay mechanism that's coming up, super delay mechanism. Do you really, as any of us think, that no matter who wins this upcoming election in the United States, that the other side is going to accept the results, you know? Is that really what's going to happen? Or are we going to have a refusal to accept the result and an insistence on a long drawn out vote counting investigation, you know, that it just, it's unsettledness, like the hanging Chad thing in Florida, right? Remember that? Where, you know, it was just super traumatic process of counting each vote and trying to determine if the chat is hanging or not hanging. And we leave our identity, our future, everything is hanging on that hanging chat. That's super delay mechanism, super delay, isn't it? That's counting the grains of sand and believing that there's some, that our identity is contingent upon the correct counting of the grains of sand on that beach. And so we are we're going to get sucked into this, pulled into this. It is a nasty, nasty thing that is coming. And there will be lawsuits, and there will be disbelief and denial and refusal, and the whole mood of the country and also the world looks at the United States. You know, they all have their opinions about the U.S. and they will also be, you know, intrigued by it, what's going on, and they will get caught up. The mood of the world will get caught up into this minutia, this belief that somehow what we are, success in happiness and getting rid of fear, depends on this endless process of litigation and counting, and you know, get pulled into that. That's why I've been saying over and over for the last 15 years, a lot of different ways I've tried, that we have to get familiar with looking at the root of the situation and recognizing that's all we need to look at. Existence, okay, it's trauma. It is to delay willful ignorance. All we have to do is choose a new idea. That's how we get rid of fear, okay? That is the teaching. Choose a new idea is the teaching. It's the ultimate teaching. And we need the ultimate teaching now because we're going into an ultimate delay-based situation in the world. Now, even if you know, so one candidate says, okay, the supporters of the candidate won't accept it. They'll say, no way, there's voter fraud. There's all sorts of stuff going on. You can see it, the cloud's coming. It's like the perfect storm is coming. And it's pretty doggone interesting that there's this supposedly perfect storm gonna sweep through Washington, D.C., you know, Eastern Seaboard, you know, the seat of kind of, you know, political heart of the nation. The super rare super storm is supposed to bring, you know, tremendous chaos and turmoil to that area right before the election. That is what's called a foreshadowing. And I know there's some of you who are wise enough to, you know, you're onto that foreshadowing of something that happens in this world, foreshadowing. And you know, I don't know how that storm Sandy is coming. Sandy Beach, counting sand, is how that will play out. But it's an attention getter, and it should have our attention to the fact that this coming political election is a perfect storm of delay and distraction. What is delay? Getting caught up in minutia, counting the trees instead of recognizing that you're in a forest, and instead of being in a forest, choosing to be somewhere else, you know. So super delay is coming up, super turmoil, very bad stuff. And just by watching these videos, you get used to it. You get used to it. You may not even, you know, like the videos that much one way or the other, but, you know, it's like working out. You know, I don't like to really work out, but you do it and you realize, you know, you're getting stronger, you're getting better, and one day you run down the street and it's easy. And you say, wow, I'm light on my feet suddenly, whereas before I could hardly shuffle my feet, now I'm light on my feet. I didn't really enjoy the workout, but I did it because I knew I had to do it. And that's kind of where we're at right now. Why I'm making these videos, you know, long, is give you the opportunity to work out, to get used to it. If it was like a 2-minute, 5-minute thing, boom, 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 okay, nice, next. Doesn't really give you a real workout. And again, working out may not be that pleasant, but if your spirit's intuitively, you say, wow, I know there's super delay coming. There's a super situation that's going to generate super delay. And if I'm not really in shape, spiritual shape, if I don't have really good spiritual fitness, meaning familiarity with looking at the big picture and comfort with looking at the big picture and willingness to look just at the big picture and dismiss all the rest of the stuff as totally inconsequential, wrong path, trying to get rid of fear by finding a way to make this threat to reality permanent through all this trauma, raindrops of trauma creating some super flood which fills the oceans, which creates a tsunami against reality. If you're familiar with dismissing all that, then you will be in a very good position coming up. You'll be able to somehow skate past it. I don't know what's going to happen. There are certain options. It's possible there's some kind of retreat, spiritual retreat. For those who are willing to look at the big picture, they may, back away for a while this turmoil is going on, to return at some point to help out. I don't know. The next several months are, as far as I'm concerned, are an open book. An open book. I don't know. From the standpoint of spiritual help, I don't know what's going to happen. I really don't. But in the meantime, get light on your feet, as it were. Get very light on your feet, metaphorically, so that you easily rise up into simply seeing the big picture and how simple it is. Spirit chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator. This rise to fear gave rise to a desire. The experience was fear, the desire to experience this and get rid of the fear led to belief that there's a way to get rid of this fear and to succeed, make this idea one that is blissful. And that attempt to do this was trauma, developing a permanent threat to reality. So to force prime creator to change reality, that notion that will get rid of the fear, trauma, and then delay as we wait for this process to work out. We have to keep delaying, because we wanna quit it, but we just keep to delay. Willful ignorance gave rise to ignoring all these delaying tactics and deceptions, and just saying no, there's no problem there, no problem there, no problem there, and now we're saddled with all this baggage of ways that we've been deceiving ourselves. So we have trauma. As we delay, we experience trauma. And we're delaying because we have this terrible fear from this idea of wanting to change reality. And the only way to get rid of that fear is to choose a new idea. We just keep looking at this. These are the elements. We just look at it. Just get used to it. You don't have to get it exactly. You just have to get used to it. Capability of move your mind, in these directions to say, in this area of consideration, be in the ballpark. Just be in that ballpark. And then you're easy to say, whoa, when belief tries to tell you to count grains of sand, you say, no, I'm not used to that. I'm not used to doing that. I want to stick with what I'm used to because I know it's right. I can get rid of fear by choosing a new idea. And the way that I've been pursuing to get rid of fear doesn't work. So that's why I'm still saddled with fear, because it doesn't work and will never work. Will never work the way we've been trying to do it, which is develop a permanent threat to reality. Any threat, it has to be permanent, or it wouldn't be really a threat, would it? A threat to permanency would have to be permanent. But we can, we're trying to develop a way to force the prime creator to change reality by threatening destruction of reality, the destruction of certainty, of permanency, of endlessness, all that. And the way we're trying to do that will never work. Working on defenses, working on traumatizing those defenses, getting past them, traumatizing something that's vulnerable, like a body mind. Continually doing that over and over and over and over and over and over and over. That doesn't work. And that's okay, because all we need to do is choose a new idea and fear is gone just like that. Gone. Forever. Because it doesn't arise in this new idea. Not trying to threat. Get comfortable. In the ballpark. Be in the ballpark. It's like going to a game, soccer game, football, baseball, basketball, whatever, whatever it is. Or an opera, any performance. You you get inside, you take your seat, you're in the arena, you're there, right? Now you can see. Whereas if you're outside, you can't see. So get in the ballpark. Once you're in the ballpark, then you can see the game. You can see how simple it is to choose a new idea. You see, that's what I need to do. Very simple. Whereas if you're not in the ballpark, you know, you're going to get swept away by distractions, by all that scenario that's been set up to delay even longer. A lot of delay, a lot of trauma is coming. Super trauma, super delay, super storm. The perfect delay, perfect trauma, you know, perfect storm is coming. And yet it's avoidable by, again, being in the ballpark with choosing a new idea, just being in that ballpark. You don't have to get it yet. I don't even have it yet, but I'm very good at being in the ballpark. And I know that's enough. You know, that's enough to move forward with whatever it is that arises for us to move with. There will be something to move with, some direction to go in that is oriented towards choosing a new idea. Those who know truth know that is the truth. That is the truth. Choose a new causal agent is how fear is. Vanishes as if it never was. Trauma gone forever, as if it never was. Simply by choosing a new idea, we can move in that direction and away from the superstorm. Away from the superstorm. The superstorm coming to the East Coast is just getting everybody into that mood, right? Of turmoil and agitation. It is just going to make the whole thing that much worse, because people are going to be freaked out. They're going to be freaked out. I know some of the viewers here are from the East Coast, so you definitely can, you know, should benefit from these videos. I'm here on the West Coast and everything is completely, you know, beautiful here and calm. I'm outside in the nighttime. It's balmy and beautiful and so calm, and you know, we're not freaking out. But those on the East Coast, of course, there's going to be that attitude, the mood of panic, like something's coming, some terrible storm is coming, you know, out of Washington. It's almost like the storm is like, you know, Washington is just pushing, you know, the political arena is going to try to engulf everyone with turmoil. Politics is very, very nasty, very nasty. I've never paid any attention to it, really. Just enough to dismiss it, you know. Wow. Well, they say it's the last refuge of scoundrels. Politics is the last refuge of scoundrels. That is very, very true. And it tries to engross our attention, you know, in more and more delay, more and more delay. Politicians that don't have a clue about how to get rid of fear. Don't have a clue, and yet they pretend they do. So everybody's all thinking that something consequential is going on. Like, oh, you know, that one, they know how to get rid of this fear, this trouble, this trauma that I have. They know how to get us to succeed, you know. No, they don't. They're completely clueless. So why are you even paying attention to them? Doesn't, you know, has no bearing on anything. Not how to get rid of fear, has no bearing on that. It actually has a bearing on how to delay, how to bring more trauma and more delay. Oh yes, it's very consequential in that regard. So, as I have said, October was all important. The momentum still is. We're not finished with it. As a matter of fact, what tomorrow's like, the 27th, I think. Let me take a look here. It's the, tomorrow is the 27th. That is fantastic. I have had the very greatest breakthroughs in my life have been on like October 27th, actually. And so it is possible, you know, Anything's possible as far as dropping the habit of belief. It's possible. I could drop it. Who knows? I'm not anticipating it or trying to make it happen or anything in particular. But October 27th has always been my, you know, lucky day, as it were. Had some incredible experiences and breakthroughs experiencing reality on October 27th. So, be a good time for it, wouldn't it? It'd be momentum. I keep saying, okay, October is momentum month. I emphasize that. If you go back to the videos, I say October, month of momentum. We have to get some momentum going. Now, when is this big storm coming in? It's coming in like what? November 1st, 2nd, 3rd, kind of thing. Yeah, November is the beginning of the troubles. No question about it. So, 5 days. Have 5 days left for October before the storm supposedly hits. The threat of it hitting is that threat is already hitting, isn't it? It's getting worse. So that threat is already hitting, and that is being hit by something. And then, you know, it could hit in November, and then the election's going to hit, and then it's just nonstop. So 5 days, more days for momentum to build here. And we'll see. We shall see. So those of you on the East Coast getting hit by this threat, continue your, you know, satsang, your inquiry, your defense against being sucked into defenses, being sucked into delay. And I will keep you in mind and keep the planet in mind, everyone here, that we need to have momentum, and I'll keep trying to do what I can do here. All right, that's enough for this video. Very great. That's it.